Good afternoon, and now we will begin the second keynote speech, and I will hand over the time to the chair, Professor Xue Liang Wang. Let's welcome him.
Thank you. Good afternoon. It's like business as usual. We have lunchbox for the meal in the conference. Actually, I have lunchbox every day when we have meetings, so it's no stress to me. It's a great honor to introduce the next keynote speaker, Professor Ba Pan. I'm just going to read through this file, short file, as he says okay, because it's shorter, otherwise it's long, like 3 pages. Professor Ba Pan is the Vicky Joseph Professor of Computer Science and Applied Mathematics in Harvard. John A. Poulsen School of Engineering and Applied Sciences, and is currently on sabbatical at National Jiao University as a visiting professor in the Department of Applied Mathematics, which is the department I graduated from, luckily, and also the Xin Tong Yao Center, and he received a PhD in Applied Mathematics from MIT, which is not made in Taiwan. Usually MIT is Massachusetts of Institute in 1999 and was the NSF postdoctoral fellow at MIT and the Institute for Advanced Study there before joining the Harvard faculty in 2001. He is a recipient of a Siemens Investigator Award and Gardel Prize, a Guggenheim Fellowship, and a Phi Beta Kappa Award for Excellence in Teaching, and the ACM Doctoral Dissertation Award. He was director of the Harvard Center for Research on Computation and Society from 2008 to 2011, and also from 2014 to 2015. Ma Pan's research area is theoretical computer science, specifically computational complexity, cryptography, and data prices. Data privacy. So without further ado, let's welcome Professor Ba Pan. Or Ba Pan, I'm sorry. But the accent is always different. So depends on accent. So let's welcome Professor.
It's a real pleasure to be here, and also a real pleasure to be in Taiwan. As Mr. Wang mentioned, I'm spending my sabbatical here, and I've been here for 2 months now. And what he said this morning about people in Taiwan, I found to be very true. We just, myself and my family, have been overwhelmed with how warm and welcoming people are here, and how making this transition halfway around the world so easy for us has been. So it's really great to be here. Okay, so I'll be talking about research in data privacy. Big data itself is not specifically my area of research, but hopefully you'll see in the talk the ways in which data privacy questions may be relevant to those of you thinking about big data. Maybe you're confronting some of these issues already, and some of the approaches that are emerging to deal with these issues. Okay, so I don't need to tell a big data or social informatics audience that there are a lot of interesting data sets out there, and increasingly we're collecting more and more fascinating information on human interactions, human behavior, and these have many potential beneficial uses. And it, we have data sets that have been collected traditionally over many centuries, like census data, but and maybe health records, but increasingly also new forms, sources of data from electronic interactions. Now the problem with reaping a lot of the benefits from these kinds of data sets is that many of them contain sensitive information about people. Information that the subjects of the data may not want to be widely revealed. And so the question in data privacy research, or the kind of data privacy research we're talking about, is how can we have the best of both worlds, in that how can we enable all the beneficial uses of data while still providing strong protections of privacy to the subjects whose data is in those data sets? Okay, so to turn this into the research questions, we need to think a bit about the two things that I've put in quotes here. What do we mean by desirable uses of data? What are the kinds of uses we want to enable? And perhaps more tricky is, what exactly do we mean by privacy? Okay, so the first one, it's easy, and I think those of you, again, in this room can come up with a much longer list than me of the potential beneficial uses of data for academic research, improving our understanding of humanity and human behavior, human health, informing government policy, identifying subjects for a drug trial, like in medical or pharmaceutical research. There's law enforcement and national security applications, and economic ones like market analysis, as well as we saw this morning, also helping NBA teams perform better is also a good use of data. You may say, well, what are the privacy concerns there? Well, what about the people in the audience? One of them may be attending a game, having skipped work without their boss knowing, and maybe that's information that someone sitting in the audience whose privacy you might want to protect. Okay, now, privacy, what we want by from privacy is a more tricky question, as I'll spend by the first quarter or third of the talk delving into what one means about privacy. Okay, so but before talking about the resolution change has hopefully not messed up too many of the figures, but I see there's a little bit of distortion here. Before talking about what we mean by privacy, let's just think of some traditional approaches or natural approaches to dealing with privacy problems and see why they don't suffice. So when you read about privacy issues in the newspaper, you'll often see computer security experts saying, the one thing people can do to protect their privacy is make sure they encrypt their data. Encryption works, we know how to do encryption well, and that's the way to solve many of your privacy problems. So I'm trained as a cryptographer, and it is true that we do know how to do encryption very well, and it does protect data very well. So you see here, I'll use this example throughout the talk, we have this toy medical data set. I'm a theorist, so through this talk we'll always have this pretend data set, no real data being shown. We could imagine taking an encryption key and encrypting every field of the data set. And you'll notice when we do encryption well, we do it so well that even the same value, if you encrypt it twice, like if you look at this male value here in sex home, it will get encrypted to different values. You can't even tell whether two values are the same when you encrypt data well. Okay, so encryption provides very strong privacy protections for whoever doesn't have the key, the encryption key or the decryption key. But what's the problem with this approach? Is that it doesn't enable any of the desirable uses of data. The encrypted data is not useful for anything. It hides all information. Right? You can't compute on this encrypted data. Okay, so encryption is good for protecting data that's at rest, not when you're analyzing it, or when it's being communicated, being transmitted. But when you need to analyze it, you need to decrypt the data, and then all privacy, you're left again with the same problem you started with. How do you protect the privacy of the subjects? So it turns out that nowadays there are some very fancy kinds of encryption that are emerging in cryptography research that do allow you to do some kind of computation on encrypted data. There's really beautiful works. A lot of it is still very much science fiction, meaning it's very far from being practical. And it doesn't quite address the kinds of issues I'll talk about in this talk, but if you're interested at some point later, I'll mention what they're called so you can look them up. All right, a second common approach that is still quite widely in use is to do what's called anonymization of the data. Okay, so what is anonymization? Well, all right, clearly it's a problem if we include people's names in this data set, so let's just drop identifying fields like that from the data set. We remove things that look like they are attaching the data record to a specific person. Name, address, maybe the exact date of birth, social security number, or your ID number. And now, looking at the data set, it's not obvious who's who, and so people have often felt, oh, this is the way to protect privacy. But as many of you in the room would realize, if you give this problem, a bit more critical thought, a problem is that information that the information that remains in the dataset, even though it's not obvious at first that it identifies people, may still be enough to uniquely specify a person in the data set and may actually be enough to figure out who is who. And, all right, this sounds like a theoretical worry that only the paranoid cryptographers might worry about, but actually time and time again it's been shown with real life examples that this is actually often very easy to do. One of the earliest examples in the computer science literature is by my collaborator, Latanya Sweeney. In the late 1990s, she took anonymized medical data that was being released in the state of Massachusetts, medical insurance claims data. And at that time, people still thought in anonymized data you could release the zip code, date of birth, and sex, because those, a lot of people share the same birth date with me. A lot of people say share the same sex as me. A lot of people have lived in the same zip code. What she realized is that despite each of these on their own seeming to be relatively safe, in combination, actually, these three fields uniquely identify well over 50% of the U.S. population. And actually, by taking the medical, supposedly anonymized medical data and comparing these three fields, linking these three fields with the publicly available voter registration list, she was able to figure out who many of the people in the anonymized medical data set were, including William Wells, who was the governor of Massachusetts at the time. And so it really made a big splash. And this is not just one example. It's happened over and over again, and even technology companies who you would think should know better, companies like AOL, who are in the business of understanding what you can do with data, have made this kind of mistake. All right, so what can we do? Well, a third approach, which is quite natural, is say, all right, let's give up on this problem of trying to release some kind of sanitized or anonymized version of the data set, and instead, let's put the data behind a wall. All right, keep it somewhere on a secure server, and let's set up an interface by which people who want to analyze the data set can analyze it. And we'll call this interface a curator. Well, this is just an algorithm, it's a computer program that will take in potential queries from data analysts and give answers in a way that protects the privacy, that gives them useful results, but protects the privacy of the data subjects. Okay, so somehow the curator needs to figure out whether certain queries are too dangerous for privacy or not, or which ones are safe to answer, or how it should modify the results of the query. All right, so this is a good approach, but it's not as simple to do right as it might seem. And the reason is, all right, so what do you want to prevent? You certainly want to prevent people from asking questions about specific people in the data set. Like, what is Mr. Ross's HIV status? That's a disease status. Right, that's clearly a question that's about a specific individual. You don't want to allow those. But what about questions that may not be obviously about a specific individual, but give people the same information? Or maybe doesn't ask about Mr. Ross, but asks about a bunch of other characteristics. Does how many people in the data set who are male, have blood type O, and a bunch of other characteristics are HIV positive? And you might try to fight with that problem by saying, okay, well, we won't give answers that are too small for these kind of counter queries. But then it's actually still easy to come up with two queries whose difference maybe will give you something about a specific individual. So this is actually quite tricky, and now there have also been a number of both theoretical and practical works showing that really even things that look like completely safe aggregate statistics that are not even devised necessarily in a devious way, but just released because one thinks they're safe statistics, can reveal a huge amount of individual information if you're not careful. This was shown some striking work by theoretical results by Dinder and Nassim, that inspired the line of work I'm going to talk about in this talk. Then there was more practical work on genomic, showing that in releases of statistics on genomic data sets had vulnerabilities where you could determine whether someone was in a particular case group or not. So whether they were in a particular data set of patients who have a particular disease. And this led the National Institutes of Health in the US to take down online available genomic statistics. And then there was also an attack on an interface engine like this that was set up by the Israeli Census Bureau. So this is a real problem, and real mistakes are being made in practice. All right, so now let me lead to this. This is rather than depress you with negative examples throughout the talk. Let me turn now to the positive side, and that is this line of work on what's called differential privacy, which is a mathematical framework for understanding when an interface, like the one I described, is privacy protective or not. And to have really assurances that we haven't made some mistake and someone's not going to write a paper, publish a paper the next day showing how you can extract all kinds of individual information. All right, so it's a mathematical theory for, a quantitative theory for how we can protect individual level information while allowing, on the utility side, all kinds of rich statistical analysis. So you want to let global statistical information out and protect individual level information. Okay? And this is, for the talk, I'll be mostly talking about it, I will entirely talk about this, the main setting in which differential privacy has been studied, which is where a single trusted curator holds all the data. So I did mention that there's other work in cryptography that helps you think about and approach privacy problems. They differ from differential privacy, right? And this includes these fancy new forms of encryption that you may have heard of, fully homomorphic encryption, functional encryption. They are dealing with different choices for what kind of trust of who's going to hold the data, right? So you may not have a single trusted curator who can hold all the data. What kind of utility you want to enable. So they allow, in some sense, you decide whatever you mean by utility, they can allow it. And then they'll protect privacy as much as possible given what you want from utility. Okay, but it turns out they're quite subtle for understanding what kind of privacy protections are provided by these methods is quite subtle, and you could run into some of the same problems that I mentioned earlier if you're not careful. But it's really beautiful work that I won't be talking about at all in this talk. I just wanted to mention it for completeness. All right, so let's get back to talking about differential privacy and how we formalize what we mean by privacy. All right, so and this emerged in a line of work starting a little over a decade ago, a series of papers in theoretical computer science. Dinur, Nassim, Dwar, and others involved in this line of work. And the idea of differential privacy is what we want to require is that the effect of each individual in the data set should be hidden from the outside, all right? From people who are accessing the data from the outside, these analysts, the effect of each individual in the data set should be hidden in some precise sense. Just a remark, I dropped the name field from here, not because it's important for differential privacy, we could keep it there, but just because of horizontal space on the slides. It is not. Differential privacy does not require that you anonymize the data set. Okay, so how is this formalized? So instead of analysts outside the accessing the data, well-intentioned analysts, what differential privacy is, imagine even an adversary who is asking cleverly chosen questions of the system in an arbitrary way in order to try to extract information about a specific individual they might be targeting. And now we have our actual data set. And so what differential privacy imagines as a mental experiment is say, suppose the adversary is interested in targeting a specific individual, like this row two here of the data set. And as a mental experiment, imagine that we take this person's data, erase it from the data set, and possibly replace it with arbitrary other values that have nothing to do with that actual person. Okay, so we have the actual data set, and then as a mental experiment, the data set where we take an individual's data and replace it with arbitrary other values. And the requirement of differential privacy, which we will make more precise, is that an adversary interacting with the system shouldn't be able to tell the difference between these two worlds. Right? The data set with the system it's interacting with, using a data set with your data in it, and one with your data erased or replaced with arbitrary values. All right, so before making this more precise, let's see an example of how one might achieve this strong kind of privacy protection. And we want this to hold regardless of what other information the adversary might have. Even if the adversary takes other data sets that are out there, like these publicly available voter registration lists, or even if it already knows a lot about the individual in question, it's a disgruntled employee or a former spouse or someone who has some vendetta against the person. Even if the adversary has all this other information, it still shouldn't be able to tell the presence or absence of that person from the data set. All right, so how could we achieve this? Let's see an example. Imagine, all right, the most basic kind of question, and the kind I'll be talking about most of the talk, you might ask, statistical question you might ask about a data set are what we call counting queries. What fraction of the population have some characteristics? For example, what fraction of the population are blood type B and HIV positive? Or any other predicate, any other property you're interested in of rows in the data. Right, here I'll use N always to denote the number of people in the data set, the size of the population. We imagine again each row is one person. Well, so how might I answer such a question with differential privacy? This N should be a C for curator. Well, I could compute the exact answer and add a little bit of random noise to the result. And the claim is that I only need to add a small amount of random noise, at least as the data set grows. So what's the reason for that? Well, imagine again, I take one row in the data set and I change it with arbitrary other values. How much could it affect the answer, the actual answer to this query? Well, counting a fraction of people in the data set, it will affect the actual answer by plus or minus 1 over n. So intuitively, if I add an amount of random noise to the result that's a little bit bigger in magnitude than 1 over n, I should be able to obscure the effect of each individual. Okay, so noise on the order of 1 over n. We'll make this all more precise. And the point here is that the amount of error that you're introducing to these percentages that you're computing goes to zero as n goes to infinity. Right? So you're getting accurate results. And in fact, it's going to zero faster than the kind of error, statistical error, you'd expect just from your sampling error. And typically, for your sampling error, you'll expect an error on the order of 1 over the square root of n. Okay, so this is just a simple illustrative example, but an important one. And another important comment, which you might already be wondering about, this is just for answering one query. Right? That's not very useful on its own. But we will talk about it, and it will be a major subject of the rest of the talk. What about one query? Alright, but before delving into that in more detail, now let's return with that example in mind to the formal definition of differential equations. So as we've seen, the way in which we're going to protect privacy is by introducing randomization at the interface. Okay, so that the curator, the interface, will inject some random noise into the way it records answers in a carefully chosen and calibrated way so as to protect the privacy of the native subjects. And it'll also be carefully calibrated to give as much utility, as much accuracy as possible. All right, but differential privacy is getting at what we want from privacy. Right, so now, once we know that this is randomized, we can now be more precise about the definition of differential privacy. What it requires is that for every pair of data sets, right, so that differ on one row. So for any data set and any then data set you can obtain by erasing an individual's data and replacing with arbitrary other values. And any sequence of queries that a potential adversary might ask. What we demand is that the probability distribution of results that the interface provides, joint distribution of all the results it provides, should be approximately the same under database D or under the neighboring database D prime, where one row can change. This should hold for regardless of the data set and regardless of which row you change, and regardless of what queries they have. Right? And when I say probability distribution, again, this is over the randomization, the random noise introduced by the interface. We're not assuming any statistical model on the data in our definition of privacy. Because if we're wrong about that model, we don't want people's privacy to be violated. It's requires a hold for all data sets and neighbors. So, important comments, parameter here is epsilon, which is measuring the level of privacy protection. That's governing how close these two probability distributions should be. All right, so the smaller epsilon is, the closer the distributions, and the stronger the level of privacy. All right, so for this definition, it turns out to be important exactly how you measure closeness and probability distributions. You might imagine lots of choices. Total variation distance, KM relative entropy, what is used to have the right semantic properties capture our intuitive meaning of privacy. Differential privacy is a multiplicative definition where we require that for every event it holds under database D and database D prime with approximately the same probability up to a multiplicative factor that's close to 1 plus epsilon. Okay, but this level of detail won't really be coming up throughout the talk, in case you're curious. And once we have this precise definition, we can also be more precise about the mechanism I mentioned that adds random noise. It informs us about what probability distribution we should use for the noise. Okay, so the first thing we think of might be Gaussian noise to add to the results. Gaussian noise works, but it turns out the best thing to use for differential privacy, given the definition, is what's called the Laplace distribution, which is a two-sided geometric distribution. And the magnitude of noise, before I said it was on the order of 1 over n, well, how much bigger than 1 over n it is should be governed by this privacy protection parameter epsilon. Right? So the more privacy protection you want, the larger the amount of noise you should have. Okay, so that's just for answering one query. A very useful privacy, you might wonder about asking many queries, and a very useful property of differential privacy that allows us to answer many queries is that it satisfies nice composition theorems. And so in particular, one tight composition theorem from joint work with Cynthia Dwork and Guy Rothblum says that if I run k differentially private algorithms, the privacy parameter, the level of privacy protection degrades by a factor on the order of roughly square root of k. At most. Okay, so it turns out it's very, the first thing you might think of is that it degrades by a factor of k, and that's actually quite, that is quite easy to show. It was proven in the first works on differential privacy that the privacy degrades by at most a factor of k. But it turns out that as you start asking many queries, it actually degrades more slowly than the square root of k, which is good because it allows you to answer more queries with the same level of privacy. Okay, so now if we want to answer more queries, we should increase the amount of noise that we introduce by a factor of about square root of k to compensate for this degradation. All right. So this is the one of the most basic differentially private mechanisms. And what this tells us, all right, if I want the amount of error that I'm introducing to these fractional answers, right, that are between 0 and 1, if I want that to be tending to zero, I can use this mechanism for up to roughly n squared queries. Right? If k is significantly smaller than n squared, n is the size of our data set, I will get a good level of epsilon level of privacy protection. And error codes, accuracy. All right. So this is a barrier in the sense that if we're using this basic mechanism, if we want our system to be able to answer more of these simple types of queries than n squared, it's not going to be possible with differential privacy. We're going to have to shut off the system and say we can't release any more information, otherwise privacy will. So in some settings, right, this is big data conference, so if big data means big N, right? N squared is quite big, right? Take big and square it. And this may still be a lot of queries. But of course, in practice, there are many data sets where N is not huge. Or you might be interested in answers that are quite small. They're asking about some subpopulation, and so you need your error to be small relative to the size of that subpopulation, not relative to the size of the entire data set. So some bad news, right? So I'm also by training complexity theorems, computational complexity, which means a lot of what I do for a living is prove negative results, show that you can't do well for some problems. And so some of the results is that there are some important cases where this n squared is not just an artifact of this particular algorithm, but it's really an inherent barrier. Okay? So one such result is with Dwork and R, saying if we compute the answers independently, meaning when I'm answering the 10th query, I don't pay attention to what the previous 9 queries were. Okay, imagine you have independent servers answering the queries. Okay? They don't like the negative result, so. So in this case, you can't do better than n squared. And another case in which you can't do better than n squared is that if you have very high dimensional data. All right, so imagine the queries that you're asking, you have a short and fat data set, many columns. Okay? And the queries that you're asking are the attribute means. All right? What fraction of people in the data set are male? What fraction of people in the data set are blood type A? And so on. I'm doing separate queries on each column. then there's also no way to take advantage of the of correlations between the queries, as n squared is a fundamental barrier no matter what you do, no matter how you try to design this interface. Any interface is going to suffer from a violation of differential privacy. And what we showed in the most recent work is not only does it suffer from a violation of differential privacy, it actually is subject to a pretty realistic attack, the same kind of attack that took that led to the takedown of the genomic data databases that I mentioned earlier. Okay, that you might be able to tell whether you pick up someone's DNA from a cup, and you might be able to tell whether they were in the data set of people with a particular disease on which statistics were released. Okay, so again, I don't want to leave you with being depressed, and what we will turn to in a moment is, all right, so this is saying, you know, negative results in computer science are never the end of the road. What they do is they point you to where there's hope, right? This tells you where there's hope is where, well, one, we should take advantage of the relationships between the queries that are passed. We should not answer each query separately. And second, we should exploit bounded dimensionality of our data. All right. But before doing that, let me just mention a couple of other survey type things about differential privacy. One, in this talk, I'm only talking about these simple fractional counts of differential privacy, because they are the most basic problem, and there's still fascinating open questions about them. And they are a starting point for doing lots of other interesting stuff. And people have done designed differentially private algorithms for many of the other kinds of data analysis approaches that you all take, for all kinds of machine learning and regression and clustering and social network analysis type problems. I won't be talking about them in the talk, and in some cases they are doing very different things than what I have described to you. All right, so the nice thing about differential privacy, from separating the requirement of what we mean by privacy from how you achieve it, is that it opens up your design space. So now you have this requirement, and no one says that the way you have to achieve privacy is by adding random noise to the compute the exact answer and then add some random noise. You can inject randomness anywhere in the process of the computation as long as you can show that this final requirement of differential privacy is satisfied. Meaning that if you change one row of the data set, it won't be distinguishable from the outside. All right, so if you're interested, there was a nice workshop, I guess now it's almost 2 years ago, on big data and differential privacy, where you could see talks and references to a lot of these works. And of course, there's been a lot of progress since then. All right, a second thing I want to do before diving into more technical detail is just mention some more kind of interpretation of the privacy protections. Okay, so, as I've stressed, right, what's protecting is individual level information, and the protections hold. The adversary won't be able to tell the difference between your data in the data set and your data removed, no matter what other auxiliary information it has, because these probability distributions are approximately the same. But a couple of caveats. Okay, sometimes what we mean by utility is leaking individual level information. Right, suppose you want to identify subjects for a drug trial, or you want to figure out which NBA player is not following the tactic, or you want to pick out a potential terrorist threat from a database. Okay, here what you mean by utility is pulling out individual level information, and differential privacy wouldn't let you do it. So if you want to support those kind of, that's what you mean by utility, you need to have a different notion of privacy. Right? I don't have a suggestion for what it should be. Some of those other cryptographic methods I suggested can be a useful tool. Second important caveat is there's no guarantee that your data subjects won't be harmed by the result of the analysis. Okay? no one knows what crazy decisions a government or company might take on the basis of what they learn about a population from data analysis. Okay, so at some point, governments learned from data analysis that smoking is correlated with lung cancer, and started by banning smoking in all kinds of public places. And smokers may claim that they have been harmed by this. And what differential privacy says doesn't tell you that you won't be harmed, but what it tells you is that it won't be because of your data and the data set that you were harmed. Right? The same outcome would have been nearly as likely to happen even if your data had been replaced by someone else's data. All right, good. So that's just some discussion on the definition. Let's return to this question of trying to answer many queries with differential privacy. Suppose we want to go beyond this n squared barrier that I mentioned. So as we know, we need to take advantage of bounded dimensionality of the data. All right, so let's assume that data dimensionality is significantly less than n squared. Okay, so I don't have a really wide and fat data set. Then what some remarkable work of Lumlig and Roth and the state-of-the-art results along these lines is due to Hart and Rothblum tells us is we can support answers to a huge number of queries once the dimensionality is bounded. And in fact, we can do so in a very appealing way. We can generate what's called a synthetic data set. Okay? So this is a data set where the rows have the same type as rows in the original data set, same attributes, but there's no one-to-one correspondence between the rows in this synthetic data set and the original. They are fake people that have been constructed by the interface, by the curator, to reflect the statistical properties of the original data. And what Blum, Ligon, and Roth, and Hartblum, a special case, Hart and Rothblum show, a special case of their results is that we can do the synthetic data generation in a way that satisfies differential privacy and preserves the fraction of the population with every set of attributes that you're interested in. All right, so take any combination of attributes. What fraction of the people in the data set are female and blood type B? What fraction of people in the data set are male, blood type O, and HIV positive? All right, so for any subset of the attributes and any values for those attributes, the synthetic data set will have approximately the same answer as the original data. All simultaneously, these exponentially many combinations. Exponentially many combinations indeed in the dimensionality of the data. And this whole synthetic data set as a whole will satisfy differential privacy, meaning that you can safely publish it and throw away the original data set and let people analyze the synthetic data set. So it's a really amazing result. The problem with it, unfortunately, is that it's very computation intensive. The amount of computation time it requires is exponential in the dimensionality of your data. Okay, and so once you reach 50 or 100 attributes, running the original form of the algorithm at least, your computer will never complete. Running the fastest computers today will still take more than the lifetime of the universe so far with a hundred or a few hundred attributes. Okay, so again, well, maybe this is just a better algorithm that we can use. And in fact, people have done some nice work on heuristic versions of these algorithms where we don't have a proof about the running time. Okay? But in practice, on many instances, they can run much faster than the original. But there's still a question about do we need to rely on this, hoping the algorithm will finish quickly, or can we have an algorithm that's guaranteed to terminate quickly? And what I showed with my student John Allman a few years ago is actually, in the worst case, this does require exponential computing time. No matter how clever you are in trying to design this interface, the algorithm. Specifically, what we showed is that if there's an algorithm that can do this in sub-exponential time, you could break all cryptography that's known, all cryptography in sub-exponential time, something that for many years has been conjectured to be impossible. Great question. That's a great question. So the question was, will the synthetic data lose some usefulness? And that's a very important question. And so the only guarantee that we have, from the algorithm is just what I said. Okay, that the fraction of people in the data set with any combination of attributes is approximately the same as the original data. Now, there are some kinds of statistical analyses where one can reason that this kind of reflecting these kinds of, this is the sort of the full contingency table of the data set, that the full contingency table is a sufficient statistic, and in some cases it's robustly so that even if you approximate the full contingency table, your analyses will still work approximately the same. But for without an analytic result like that, if you do something other than what we provide the guarantee for, we don't know. And in part, that's something to be investigated in empirically to see, okay, these synthetic data sets we get, how good are they? But this is a problem also. I mean, a lot of statisticians in practice have been using synthetic data generation to deal with privacy problems for a number of decades. These methods come with even less in the way of guarantees about utility, but still they seem to be useful in practice. And they don't come with any guarantees about privacy other than they seem to be. All right, so what can we do? As I said, again, my first tendency to work in an area is to come up with a negative result because that's my training. But it always is a pointer to where to look for a positive result. And what this result told us is that one place we can look for a better algorithm is to remove the, so our negative result really relies on the fact that your algorithm is producing a synthetic data set. No one says, the synthetic data set was just a means to an end. It was a way of summarizing this exponential amount of statistical information about the original data set. It's a very nice one because people can then pretend it's the actual data. But we don't need to tie our hands this way. We can allow ourselves to summarize the data in some other form that still allows us to capture all the same statistical information. And one thing that we have shown is by using some kind of approximations coming from multivariate polynomials, which I won't have time to describe, we can actually produce summaries in a differentially private way that, again, allow you to approximate the fraction of people with any combination of attributes in the original data, and it can be computed in some exponential time. But only mildly sub-exponential. Actually, before I say, what do I mean by multivariate polynomials? So what you release is some coefficients of a big multivariate polynomial as your summary. And when you want to now ask a particular query, you can just plug in values for the variables and see the result, and that will be guaranteed to be a good approximation of the query that you're interested in. All right, so but sub-exponential is not necessarily good enough. It's not linear time or quadratic time. It's only 2 to the square root of the number of dimensions, rather than 2 to the number of dimensions. And there's a very big open problem. One of the big theoretical questions in the field, is there a polynomial time algorithm, linear, quadratic, cubic, something scaling as a polynomial in the functionality. All right. This one, so that's one amazing possibility of differential privacy, the potential for producing very rich summaries of exponential amounts of statistical information. Another one, which I won't talk about in so much detail, is there's similar, very general results about doing statistical inference in machine learning. Some of these results don't have that kind of exponential computation barrier that I mentioned. And the kinds of results is that the convergence rates of your statistical estimation, your inference procedures, is asymptotically the same as your convergence rates without privacy. Right, as n tends to infinity. And for big data, with privacy, is performing approximately well as the analysis without privacy. But there is still quite a ways from turning these theoretical results into things that really work well in practice, because n is not going to infinity, even if it's very large. All right, so let me see where I am on time. All right, maybe I'll just take 5 minutes. I don't work on social informatics at all, but I thought since this is big data and social informatics, it's worth saying a few things about what does differential privacy have to say about social informatics. And I borrowed some slides from my colleagues, Sofia Raskolnikova, who is one of the experts, has done some of the nicest work in this area, just to give you a taste of what's okay, so again, I don't need to tell this audience. There's a lot of interesting information in social network graphs, and also a lot of this information is very sensitive personal information. Traditional approach, again, for dealing with privacy is anonymization. But here the risks with anonymization are even more severe than they are with traditional tabular data. Because the graph structure itself is something that you need to worry about. So this is a data set that some of you may have seen back from some sociologists, Bierman et al., of the romantic relationships between some high school population, I believe. Blue is male, red is female here. And a lot of interesting things about this graph. A lot of sociologists, I guess, have talked about it. And they've removed the names, so you're not being told who's who in this data set. But the worry is that the graph structure itself can be a source of privacy compromise. And in a typical real-life network like this one, many nodes have unique neighborhoods, unique graph structures, even just very locally around them. Right? So, this slide keeps advancing on its own. So, in particular, this is a very interesting neighborhood here of this boy who has romantic relationships with quite a few girls, as well as one other boy. You may know, for example, this structure, you may know about a couple of these relationships here. These two boys have both had relationships with these two girls. Okay, but you may not know about the edge between those two boys. And it turns out this structure, this graph, this little structure here is unique. Okay? And so if you see now the anonymized network and you look for this structure, you find this boy is the only place where it's present, and you learn about this relationship that you didn't know about. So, very worrisome, and then again, there have been a number of practical attacks shown on de-anonymizing supposedly anonymized social and other kinds of network data. All right, so now, what does differential privacy mean for graph or network data? Throughout, I was talking about data sets that were tabular, each person is a row, and I said, for every two data sets that differ on one row. Well, for graph data, right, I have a graph, not a tabular data set. And presumably I want to say, for every two graphs, G and G prime, that differ on what? What should What should be our unit of privacy protection? Yes. Well, there's two choices here. All right, so what do we mean by relationships? So the first, the easiest to deal with is what's called edge differential privacy, where you talk about two graphs or neighbors if they differ on one edge. Okay. But this is a very weak kind of privacy protection. It's only protecting the individual connections. So it might do okay for that boy I was talking about before, who might be interested just in the privacy of this one edge. But in general, someone may be interested in the total, all the relationships they're involved with in at once. Okay, node differential privacy says two graphs are neighbors if they differ on, if they're the same up to modifying a node and all the edges that are adjacent to it, reconnecting the person to any other set of nodes. So node differential privacy is a much stronger requirement, and hence much harder to achieve, and only in the last 2 years are there even theoretical results showing that we can actually do a lot of interesting things satisfying node differential privacy.
Can you kind of combine the concept into a subgroup?
Yes. Yes, so it can be extended to talk about privacy protection at the level of subgraphs or neighborhoods in small radius and so on. Yes, yes, it can be done. Though I don't know if any work has been done on the design of algorithms for that. All right, and so, you know, here, I guess I won't go through this, but people, again, have just been starting to study what kinds of statistics you can do with differential privacy and graph analysis. It's a very, you know, kind of just emerging area. There's a nice survey by Raskolnikova and Smith just from this year if you're interested in catching up on the state of the art. All right, so I think I will wrap up. I wanted to give you a taste of two aspects of differential privacy. Well, one mainly that it provides a strong. It's really time to wrap up. So hopefully I've convinced you that at least from a theoretical point of view, differential privacy has turned out to be extremely interesting. One thing that maybe hasn't come across so much in the talk is it's amazing how it's connected with many other theoretical areas of research, very deep, fascinating connections. But because privacy is such an important problem for society these days, there is also a huge amount of interest from other communities outside the theoretical computer science community where differential privacy emerged in trying to bring differential privacy to practice. And there are all kinds of challenges that I won't talk about. I normally talk about these things instead of social informatics, but I thought the social network stuff was more relevant for a lot of this audience. Just mention here, there's a number of efforts happening in the US and probably other places in the world as well, trying to bring differential privacy to practice. There's a product that Google has that's using some form of differential privacy, actually in practice. And we have a big project at Harvard that's joint with social science and law and statistics, along with computer science, in trying to develop privacy tools for the sharing of research data in social science and other fields. So I won't tell you exactly what we're trying to do. We're trying to build differential privacy tools and others for data repositories. Skip all of this. I'd say the state of bringing differential privacy, there are some real challenges that we and others are thinking about and working on. But I think there is a lot of reason for optimism, and we are seeing some success cases already. And hopefully, in the coming few years, you'll start to see differential privacy going from something that might be useful for privacy protection to something that actually is ready to be used on an increasing scale.
Do we have any questions? We have a few minutes, and after that we can talk privately. That's great. Do we have questions? Oh, can I ask? Okay, go ahead.
It seems to me that the definition of privacy is just liable to statistical counting. Such as when you do some aggregation, which is the breach of privacy, if I want to do some further analysis, do we have some solution for that?
Yes, sorry if I wasn't clear in the talk. Let me go back. Point of. The point of this slide is to just give you a small taste of a lot of work that has been done and is being done on differential privacy for all kinds of other analysis beyond the fractional counts. Fractional counts were just this most basic thing that I talked about in this talk, because there's still a lot of things we don't understand or just starting to understand about the counting queries, but there people have studied, for example, doing singular value decomposition, right? Or regression. In fact, we're also currently doing a lot of work on statistical inference and least squares regression and other kinds of regression with differential privacy. And this is very partialist. So there is a big literature on doing other richer kinds of analysis. And I suggest you go to the web page of this workshop if you want to see some examples and pointers.
So it can be applied to general pattern recognition problem, because as long as it can be correlated to feature correlation or feature extraction, you try to represent something, and you can use this method to randomize it so that the privacy can be protected. Is that right?
In principle, yes. Assuming what one is talking about, again, is you need to be able to a priori identify the unit of privacy protection. So for example, if you have a data set of images, and each image is that's the level at which you want to do privacy protection, then differential privacy can apply on some aggregate that you're doing over many images. But if you're taking a single image and asking if you can protect the many individuals who are in that image, that becomes a little bit, that becomes trickier to define what is one individual's information in this data set. And probably there are ways that can be inspired by differential privacy thinking about it, but I don't know that anyone has done that so far.
So before doing that, you have some things to interact with some individual topics, right? Because maybe we can set up something, because we want to do some privacy protection on some stuff. Then we need to design the mechanism to interact with this kind of thing systematically.
Yes.
Is that right?
Yes. And most of the work on differential privacy has really been on this, and certainly stuff bringing into practice on designing systems to interact with tabular data sets, or more recently these graph-based data sets, very discrete kind of. Where there's discrete units of information. I don't mean that the values themselves are discrete. And I think with the
how to interact with the data in the case of pattern recognition, which is, again, something hasn't been confronted. I think it's very interesting.
In one of the slides, you mentioned approach to hide privacy by adding noise data, like fake data, fake people, fake things. So when you add in this, I'm thinking typically maybe adding the, you know, if you're talking about structured database, is any more rows by more people is one. But is there any way you need to add more columns to hide your data?
I haven't seen so often the model that's taken, the viewpoint that's taken, is that the, you know, the code book for your data set is public information. You know the fields ahead of time, that you decide, these are the fields I'm going to collect data on. I know that even in advance of actually interacting with the population. So there's not so much to protect in what your columns are. You don't need to add new columns. I will think offline a little bit, but I can think of an example where you might want to do that for privacy.
In the final part, you mentioned graphs. There's some potentials and those.
Yes. I mean, if you want to think of the graph as a matrix, then you know a person is not a row, but it's a row and a column pair. Yes, that's right.
Ask one question. Most of the anonymization techniques on tablet or graph data, they have an issue of trade-off between privacy and utility. How about differential privacy? Do you have that issue?
Yes. So the trade-off between, so some of these negative results that I talked about in these early ones of Demir and Nissim show actually there is an inherent trade-off between privacy and utility. That if you want to release too much information that's too accurate, no matter how you do it, there are some very devastating attacks where you can reconstruct almost all the private information in the data, even for any data set, no matter what kind of sort of model it's come from. So that is inherent, is our extension, the trade-off between privacy and utility. What the advantage or the benefit of differential privacy is that it's a quantitative theory for reasoning about that trade-off. Not making a guess about where you are on this privacy versus utility curve, but actually being sure about what point you are.
Do you have any other questions? If not, so we can close this session. So let's give big hands to Professor Ahong.
Okay, thank you. Originally, we have no break between this keynote and the next one, but I think maybe most of you guys to take a restaurant or have some drink. Oh, okay.
To show our appreciation, just a little bit of a break. So this is a certificate of appreciation we'd like to present to Professor Murray.
So we have 5 minutes break, and after that, please back to this bank hall, and we will begin the next keynote speech. Only 5 minutes, please. Thank you very much.